Okay, welcome everyone to the Midnight Study. We are changing our lives, drawing energy of immortality. So the reason why we do this is because midnight is a time that normally our body wants to sleep. And the Kabbalist shares that when you go against your nature, you create the most miracles. And it's the end of the week. We are very much looking towards the weekend, or for Kabbalists, Shabbat, the end of the week. And we want to rest. However, spiritually, there's something else happening. It's a huge elevation. And our consciousness is elevating. Our energy is elevating. Our souls are elevating. And we want to take this opportunity to elevate, to connect with whatever is available, to really create the biggest miracles in our life. And Kabbalistically, the biggest miracle that we can ever have is change and elevation of consciousness. That's the true miracle. It's not something external, but it's internal, because our external world is governed by our consciousness, by our mindset, by our attitude, by our subconscious. That is the determining factor of our surrounding. And the biggest miracle is not something that happens on the outside. The biggest miracles is something that happens inside our soul, inside our consciousness. When we stop being dependent on the outside and become more and more dependent on the inside, on how what's happening inside of us, and elevating the insides of us, and elevating the consciousness, obviously. And also, just a quick reminder, what's the biggest difference between wisdom of Kabbalah? And there's so many different practices now, and even Judaism, it's not obviously connected to Kabbalah, and or religion, spiritual stuff, etc. Everything is working on a physical level. Everything is helping you do something with the physical. The wisdom of Kabbalah, as the Rav used to say, and Rabbi Shimon, says still, it's about immortality. It's about removal of chaos completely. That's the true energy and purpose of wisdom of Kabbalah and the book of Zohar. It's not just shots of wheatgrass. It's not just the cold shower that's going to make you feel good for a day. It's going to make your life a little bit better. This is about completely changing life. So that's the true purpose of wisdom of Kabbalah. And the Zohar is our most powerful tool. We have immortality within us. It's not something outside of us. It's something that we want to remove that's preventing immortality from being a normal thing in our life, in every way, in immortality in relationships, immortality in business, immortality in health, immortality on every level of our existence, really. And it's a crazy idea. It's a little bit out there. It's very true, obviously. It's something that scientists say is possible. So we're going towards that. And really probably the biggest driving force for that is the wisdom of Kabbalah. So, and this study, it's helping every single one of us achieve that, and also broadcast this light to the whole world, to our loved ones, to our families, our friends, and the whole world, really. That the whole world will be, because once immortality is achieved, it's not an individual just for me, it's for the whole human race. So what we're doing is we have achieved a lot, and we are achieving more and more right now. So we start to study with a prayer that was written by Rabbi Yitzhak Luria in order to build a vessel and to draw more and more light for this study. So I'm saying it out loud for all of us to do it together. So it's not just me who's doing it. I'm doing it for all of us. Ruler of the universe and master of all masters, the Father of mercy and forgiveness. We thank you, our God and God of our fathers, by bowing down and kneeling, that you brought closer to your Torah and your holy work, and you enable us to take part in the secrets of your holy Torah. How worthy are we that you grant us with such big favor? That is the reason we plead before you that you will forgive and acquaint all our sins, and they should not bring separation between you and us. And may it be your will before you, our God and God of our fathers, that you awaken and prepare our hearts to love and revere you. And may you listen to our utterance and open our closed heart to the hidden studies of your Torah. And may your study be pleasant before, may our study be pleasant before your place of honor, as we aroma of sweet incense. And may you emanate to us light from the source of our soul to all of our being. And may the sparks of the holy servants, which you revealed your wisdom to the world, shine. May their merit and the merit of their fathers and the merit of their Torah and holiness support us, so we should not stumble for our study. And by their merit, enlighten our eyes and our learning, as it is stated by King David, the sweet singer of Israel. Open my eyes that I will see wonders from your Torah, because from his mouth God gives wisdom and understanding. May the utterance of my mouth and the thoughts of my heart find favor before you, God, my strength and my dear. What I do now is I randomly open a section of the Zohar that the Creator and Rabbi Shimon and Rav feel that we should be reading right now. Okay, so if you have your Zohar in the English volume, it's section number 16, paragraph 279. And the way we do it is we read Aramaic and then we read the English and decipher it. So 279, if you want to follow along or listen, it's either way is good. אתם רשים אשר עשיתי למצרים ואשר איתכם על כנפי נשרים. מי כנפי נשרים? אמר רבי יהודה, ברחמי דיקטיף נשר יאיר כינו וגו. וכיינו רזה דאמר רבי שמעון דרך הנשר בשמיים. מי בשמיים ברחמיים? מה נשר? השתקח ברחמי על בנוי ודינה לגבי אחרנים. כך קדוש ברוך הוא השתקח ברחמי לגבי ישראל ודינה לגבי ימים. עין כף אב מם. Now in English. And you have seen what I did to Egypt and how I bore you on eagle's wings. This is actually one of my favorite lines in the whole Old Testament. It's very beautiful. The Creator is telling Israelites that you have seen what I did to Egypt and how I bore you on eagle's wings, meaning I took you out on eagle's wings. What does eagle's wings mean? Rabbi Yehuda said that eagle's wing means mercy, as it is written in the verse, as an eagle stirs up his nest, meaning that an eagle signifies mercy. And this is the secret in Rabbi Shimon's words, the way of vultures in the air. This is from Mishlei. In the air means with mercy. For Zerampin is called heaven and has mercy, for Chesed, Gura, and Tiferet are judgment and mercy. As the eagle watches mercifully over its own young, but is cruel towards others, so is the Holy One, blessed be He, merciful towards Israel, but judges the heathen nations severely. So that means that when you go through change, leaving Egypt, or Egypt is simply a cold word, it has nothing to do with a nation, it's not a country, it's a state of mind, it's belief in physicality, it's over belief in physicality, it's when you worship the physical, when you are, physicality to you is very important, money, how you look, your house, how you feel, etc. All these physical things are extremely important to you. And not letting go, being very attached to physicality. And the Creator is saying, you see what I did to Egypt, you see what I did to the ego, and I took you out of it, I took you out of your old false beliefs in a merciful way, in an easy way. And what it means, heathen nations is anyone that doesn't believe in the real Creator. Real Creator meaning everything happens for the best, everything happens for a reason. Obviously, sometimes it's hard for us to accept that, so we have some time to, process whatever is happening, but eventually we want to come to a place. Sorry, I just turned on sage and still burning. So we want to come to a place that we realize, you know what, that was for the best. That was for the best, whatever it was. The more you come to that in your life, the more connected to a Creator you're going to be. And the less, the more quote unquote difficult experience you're going to go through, because the Creator is going to be pushing you and telling you, let it go, move on. It's not the truth. This is the truth. The truth is letting go, being connected to the light, and being in mercy also. Obviously, the Creator's functions in a merciful way. Unconditional love, it's the ultimate expression of the Creator. Okay, next paragraph, 280. Rabbi Elazar, chava azil mikafutech kiya lelud lechava azil le Rabbi Yosi ve Rabbi Chia me kamu benichora gad nachir yamama vechayvo azle amar Rabbi Chia chemina chay kara diketiv ufane arye el chamaim learba Tam ufane shor mechashmoel lear da tam lif ufane nesher lead baratam da arie bimina shor mismala nesher ben atar duktate. So now we go to the English. So can just a little. Translation 281. Rabbi Elazar was once going from Cappadocia to Lod. Whenever somebody's traveling in the Zohar, it only means traveling of consciousness, accompanied by Rabbi Yossi and Rabbi Chia, meaning they were studying together, like what we're doing now. They had risen at sunrise, and as the light appeared, they started to walk. Rabbi Chia said, "I see the vision in which described in the verse, and they had." And they four had the face of a lion on the right side, and they four had the face of an ox on the left side. They four also had the face of an eagle. This is from Ezekiel, the prophet Ezekiel. And I wonder, if the lion is on the right side and the ox is on the left side, where is the place of an eagle? So this is a vision, and a place. There is a place in the upper worlds, in one of the spheres in the upper worlds, where you see these holy beasts. It's lion, bull, eagle, and a man. These are the four holy beasts that also correspond to the right, left, central, and malchut columns. And it's also how the world operates. 281. Amar leit Rabbi Elazar be'atav de Yaakov shriya mem ted mishum denesher bekola ishtakach rachame levanoi dina legabei acharanim כך קדוש ברוך הוא יוביל לו לישראל ברחמי ובדינה לגבי החרנים דיקטי ועשה את חל את קם על כנפי נשרים וכתיב נשר יאיר קינו. Translation. Rabbi Elazar replied, "It is a place where Jacob is, meaning the central column. The reason for this is that an eagle combines everything, both mercy and judgment. Mercy to its own young and judgment to others. So the Holy One, blessed be He, the secret of central column, led Israel with love and dealt steerly with others. It is written, and bore you on eagle's wings, and as an eagle stirs up her nest." So eagle corresponds, each one corresponds to also a patriarch. So the right is lion, or Abraham. The left is bull or Isaac. Central column is eagle or Jacob. And Malchut is man or King David. That's how it's divided. And also it shows how the more we are connected to the light, the more we are connected to mercy, the more mercy the universe will be showing to us. Okay, so that's why it's essential, you know, you want to constantly always be in the mode of mercy. That's why it says you shouldn't, you know, if your enemy asks you for a cup of water or for food, you should give it to them. You know, never say no to them. And that's the level of mercy that each one of us should have. 282. Menalan deneshe rachame yikrei diketiv derech haneshe bashamayim, bashamayim mamash. ובגין כך אריה למינה שור לשמלה, נשר בניחו ואחיד לון, אדם כליל כולחו וקולה התקלילן, בית דקטיב ועד דמות הכיסא, דמות ברחמי אדם עליו ומלילה. 282 in English. We can learn that ego signifies mercy, for it is written, the ways of vultures, literally ego, in the air, heaven, actually in heaven, which is Arampin, the properties of mercy. Therefore, the lion is on the right and the ox is on the left. The ego is between them and combines both of them. The face of a man includes all of them, and in it they are comprised, for he is the aspect of Malchut, which receives from all of them, as it is written, upon the likeness of throne was the likeness of appearance of a man above it. This is also from Ezekiel. This is vision of Ezekiel. Ezekiel was considered one of the prophets that had the highest spiritual revelations. That's why he's mentioned a lot, and that's why it says that even the lowest human being that was crossing the Red Sea still had the higher vision than Ezekiel, meaning that if he had a higher vision than Ezekiel, then it means it's like, you know, a very, very high level, right? So, and also it's interesting, central column, right, left, center, you know, you want to have a balance of mercy and judgment, right? You want to have, that's what restriction is, that's what the Rav review, the power of restriction. When you restrict, you take a pause, you take a step back, you detach from whatever is happening, and you take a look from outside, and you ask the creator, what should I do in this situation? Creator, give me a sign, give me guidance, give me assistance. What should I do? What should happen? Assist me, help me, please help me in this situation. A mini prayer of it, or meditation, we can constantly do all the time. Also central column, if you know the structure of the 10 sefirot, the center column is made out of Keter, Dat, Tiferet, and Malchut, right? Those are in the middle, in center. The right column is Chochmah, Chesed, and Netzach. The left column is Bina, Gura, and Chod. So the central column is directly connected to Keter, and Keter is directly connected to the endless. And endless is where immortality is coming from. Endless is what we want to be connecting to also. Endless is the source of all abundance and blessings in our life. Okay, next paragraph, 282. Vayechi b'yom ha-shishi v'go. Rabbi Abba patach. Achot lanu katana v'shadayim ein la ma nase v'achortenu b'yom shedubar ba. Achot lanu katana da Knesset Israel. Deikre akot lekadosh baruch hu v'shadayim ein la chayinu detanenan v'shata ledaki. לקריבו ישראל לתורה בסיני לא לחווה בחום זקהבן ועובדים תבין להגנה אליהו דיקתי ושדיים אין לה דחי נון תיקונה ושפידרו ויתתה ולית שפירו יתתה אלא, אינון מה נעשה לאחותינו, מה התאבית מינה בשעתה דקדוש ברוך הוא, התגלה בתורה בסיני למעלה, בפתגמי אורייתא ויפרח נשמתכון מיניכו. And it came to pass on the third day. Rabbi Abba opened the discussion with a verse. We have a little sister and she has no breasts. What shall we do for our sister in the day when she shall be spoken for? So, and it came to pass on the third day, is from Shemot, from this week's portion. And Rabbi Abba then links it up with a verse from Shir Shirim, Song of Songs, from King Solomon, where it's a metaphor, obviously. And now we decipher it. A little sister is congregation of Israel, which is called the sister of Holy Mubazbihi. She has no breast, as we have learned that when Israel approached Mount Sinai, they had in them no merits or no good deeds to protect them. As it is written, she has no breast. So breast, not referring to physical, but it refers to merits, meaning good deeds, also light of chasadim. Light of chasadim is called merits. For they are the beauty of a woman, and a woman's beauty comes from them alone. What shall we do for our sister? That is what will be done with them when Holy One, blessed be He, reveals Himself on Mount Sinai to proclaim the words of Torah, for their souls will fly away from them. So Mount Sinai is probably the most important event that happens in the Old Testament. It's kind of the climax of the whole creation, when the tikkun of Adam and Eve, Tower of Babel, time of Noah, the flood, Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, Yosef, Egypt, and the 600,000 people and the 3 million people, and Moses at Mount Sinai achieve immortality, basically completely remove death. Or in other words, completely remove the influence of physicality on our consciousness. It switched. Their consciousness was controlling physicality. If I wanted something from a distance, I would just think it and it would come to me. I wouldn't even actually need it to come to me. I could receive the light of anything I want instantaneously. There wouldn't be a need for me to work. There wouldn't be a need for me to earn it, to merit it. It would just be automatic. So they achieved that. And I want to bring it to now, because the wisdom of Kabbalah, there's a big misconception that wisdom of Kabbalah is about the past, ancient Kabbalists, what happened in the past. No, it's nothing at all to do with the past. It's all about the future, all about our perfected states, all about where we can be, where we should be, where we are actually, and removing the veil. Because what happened on Mount Sinai is the veil of mortality, the veil of death was removed, and they achieved what's true. So it's very crucial division. It's not that something was given, it's something was, the falseness was taken. The illusion of mortality, the illusion of chaos, the illusion of death, the illusion of pain, the illusion of suffering was taken away. And they were completely in total enlightenment. They completely saw everything as it was. So that's why they were able to see the voices and hear the signs, that there was no need for them to explain anything. They understood everything completely from the moment of creation to now. If I looked at any object, if they looked at each other, they saw everyone's past lives. You saw all of your past lives. There was no past lives. It was all one. Complete unity, complete oneness. There was no separation. There was no past, present, future. It was oneness, complete oneness with the light, complete oneness with the tree of life. And they're saying that they didn't have the merit for that. So how did they happen? You know, that's what the reference is to the breast and, you know, the line from King Solomon. Amar biyosi bechachu she'ata dekarivu Yisrael leturah desinai bechachu laila venachche telata yomin delo izdavegu leitata echu atu malachim ilin vekavilu leIsrael bechad leita v'inun malachim leila v'Yisrael malachim letata v'inun mekadshin shema ila leila leIsrael mekadshin shema ila letata. Rabbi Yossi said that the time Israel approached Mount Sinai together with that night and following morning, it was 3 days altogether, during which the people abstained from conjugal intercourse with their wives. The holy angels came and received them with fraternity, for they are angels above and Israel are angels below. They sanctify the supreme name above, while Israel sanctifies the supreme name below. So something that happened is, it says that tikkun will happen when we elevate 288 sparks of light, and also it's connected to the five final letters. They're called the Manzbach, which is the sweetening of a judgment. And actually, it says that the Israelites received new clothing or new jewels, which were the Manzbach letters. And those letters, when you receive those letters, obviously each one of us can achieve it whenever we do our correction. So when you achieve Manzbach, you achieve immortality. You achieve total victory over death, and also victory over physical reality and 1% reality. And something we can meditate on. Manzbach, Mem Nun Tzadik Pei Gaf. 285. Vitairu Israel Beshavim Kitrin Bechachu Leila Vemalkeila Chavo Amrei Achot Lanu Katena Veshadaim. Ein la velo bechu zakava leobdin tavin ma nase leachonetenu kelumar ma yakara urevu neavid leachatena da beyoma kadosh baruchu itgale betura disinai lemachel lechu oraita. And Israel were crowned with 70 crowns on that night. Then the supernal angel said, We have a little sister and she has no breasts, for they have no merits and good deeds. So what shall we do for our sister? This is, how shall we honor her on the day when the Holy One, blessed be He, reveals Himself on Mount Sinai to give them the Torah? So another thing that happened in Mount Sinai, it says that the Israelites married the Holy One. Like they had it was like a chuppah. It was like a marriage ceremony where the creator became the husband and the Israelites became the wife. And obviously, because everything that we have comes from the creator, it's all relative, right? We can also, doesn't mean women are only receivers. It also depends on the situation, right? It's all relative. But what happened is that the creator, the true creator, people were not aware. We are very much, hopefully, and got very much aware of the creator, right? We know more or less what the creator is and what the creator isn't. At that point, people were not aware at all. 286 in the Aramaic. Vayechi bayom ha-shlishli ketiv chayinu nekoin lish loshet yamim al tegeishu al isha v'chayinu bayom ha-shlishi. Rabbi Shimon amal, b'shata de-kadosh baruch hu be'a le'itgalea v'tura de-sinai kara kadosh baruch hu le'kol pe'malia dile amar lon chashta Yisrael reyan de'lo yeda'in nimu soy. Veana be eli itgale elehu I itgale elehu bechala digvura la yaklin lemis bal. Aval itgale elehu berachame vekabelun minu soy chechedalet veihi bayom ashlishi. Bayom ashlishi vaday diichu rachame menalan diketi veeten shamayim vaered. It is written, be ready by the third day, come not near a woman. And it came to pass on the third day. Rabbi Shimon said that at the time that the Holy One, blessed be He, desired to be revealed on Mount Sinai, He gathered all His retinue and told them, now Israel are like children who do not know my commandments, and I desire to be revealed before them with mercy, and they will accept my law. Therefore it is written, and it came to pass on the third day. Indeed, the manifestation took place on the third day, for it is the day of Tiferet, which is mercy. And how do we know all that? It is written, He bowed the heavens also and came down. This is from Prophet Shmuel. They're linking up. And heavens are Tiferet, which is mercy, as is explained below. So this is about what was happening at Mount Sinai. Another thing that I want to know about what happened on Mount Sinai is a complete revelation of unconditional love of the Creator. But Israelites, Michael Berg shared it also a few years ago about this Shabbat, that there was so much love that everyone experienced for each other. They were like dumbfounded. You know, they were like, they literally were speechless because they were experiencing so much love for themselves, for each other, for the Creator. It was just pure love, because really love is the Creator. That's the real revelation of the Creator. And also their desire to help their neighbor was bigger than thinking about themselves. So the person's desire to help another person was a primary function. It wasn't about, oh my God, what am I missing? It was, oh my God, like, how can I assist somebody else also? How can I help? So that was the primary energies and functions that were happening at Mount Sinai, besides many, many others. 287. Uvechai itgale, and also we want to remind ourselves, we're connecting. What they also removed is completely hatred or resentment, because that's the opposite of love. So when you resent, or you hate, or you dislike, you regret, you reject something, you reject yourself, you reject the Creator, you reject an experience, you reject a person, you reject a thought, you're basically being closed-minded. You are not open to love. You're blocking the love from coming. What they experienced is they completely were washed away from any hate, any resentment, any regret, anything. There was absolutely zero. Can you imagine yourselves without any regret? Try to imagine yourself, try to picture yourself not having the slightest feeling of shame, regret, resentment, or rejection. Can you imagine this is utopia, right? When you feel that way, you wake up in the morning, you take a breath, and it's every breath is like a gift, right? There's no like, oh, why did that happen? I wish that never happened. I wish that changed. I wish that was different. I wish this was different. No, you appreciate every second. Like, there's a good example I heard, like somebody that lives in the north in like Finland and during the winter and they don't see sun for like months, and then all of a sudden they come out one morning and they see the sun, this feeling of like, you know, wow, what an experience. That's what they had, and that's what we should be having every second. There's no reason why any single human being should not be having that every second. The only reason is obviously our opponent, our Satan, our false beliefs, our negative emotions. But again, we're also not that. We are removing that more than ever before for ourselves, for other people, for the whole world.
287.
When the Holy One, blessed be He, revealed Himself before Israel, He extended mercy at first, and afterwards He gave them the Torah from the side of Gvura on the third day. Thus, they included both mercy and judgment, as it is appropriate for them. Hence, they are called Israel, for the name Israel constitute mercy and judgment. Another beautiful thing about the whole word Israel is it's not Jews. You know, a lot of people assume that it's Jews received. It's Israelites. And Israelites is, I'm not going to go into just a breakdown of it, but only approximately 1/12 of Israel is what is known as Jews now, right? Because Jew is someone that comes from the tribe of Judah, from Judah. Judah is one of the 12 sons of Israel, and Israel had 12 sons. 12 tribes came from those 12 sons. So they are absolutely not connected to Jews. They're connected to humanity, to basically anyone whose heart opens when he connects to Kabbalah on whatever level. You know, sometimes people connect and it becomes their life way, and some people just like it and they just always say it as, yes, I am a Kabbalist. You know, and one person can take Kabbalah 1, 2, 3, or even Kabbalah 1, they're like, you know what, I'm a Kabbalist. They could be an Israelite also. We really don't know. No one really knows. 288, very good number. 288 is a number of sparks we need to elevate. There's just a quick deep study. There's 320 sparks of light or souls that humanity needs to elevate before we accomplish the final tikkun. We have in our responsibility 288. The last 32, the malchut, which is also called the heart of stone and also connected to the mansbach, will be elevated completely directly by the Creator. So once we do the 288, we still haven't done it. When we do it, you're going to see yourself fly. You're going to hear news of people flying, living immortally, etc. So once 288 is done, the Creator will do the rest 32 by them automatically. Only the Creator can elevate them. And the last 32, again, are 32 is numerical value, heart, lev. And it's also connected to the heart of stone. So we're removing the heart of stone also. That's something that the Creator will eventually lift from us. And the heart of stone is obviously connected to, again, those negative emotions. 288. Bich yot haboker, diketiv boker lo avot, ha'i chava avot, kadruta ishtekach velo itgalia chesed, ve'mate itgalia chesed, beboker, kavdalet alef, baboker or. Dekad nachir tzafera chesed ishtakacha be'alma v'dinin itav ran uvezimna delo nachir boker dinin ad kean lo itav ran tiketiv baran yachad kovei boker ve'yari'u kol b'nei Elohim kevan itvaberan v'inun beko Koka Vaya, Benacha Shimsha, Beit Ishata Diketiv Boker Lo Avot. The Chesed Ita itar be'alma data bechachi she'ata diketiv bichyot aboker ve'kevan demit baran kokavaya boker ishtakach. Boker means morning, just the reason that it repeats it. When morning came, as is written, in the morning without clouds. When morning came is from the weekly portion from Shmot, from Exodus. In the morning without clouds is from Prophet Shmuel. The Zohar always links the Old Testament, the Torah, with the prophets. See, it's incredible. You know, there's so many sentences in the Old Testament and in all the prophets. And to be able to, just if you, just appreciation, just to be able to link a sentence in the Old Testament where it says, when morning came, and then you link it to in a morning without clouds that Prophet Shmuel said in verse 20, in chapter 22, verse 4, is obviously phenomenal. You know, it's only like, and only through divine inspiration. That's what the writers of the Zohar had, a very high level of divine inspiration. And that's all what we're connecting to. Also now we're connecting to divine inspiration. For if it was cloudy morning, there would have been darkness in it, and Hesed would not have been revealed. So when there's clouds, there's a little bit of darkness. And just like, you know, in New York, for example, on the East Coast, we haven't had a sun for 3 days when we had a storm. And on the third day, I'm like, something's missing. Something's like not right. And then I'm realizing, oh, we didn't have a sun for 3 days. Sun is energy of, it's not just a planet. It's energy of mercy. It's energy of Hesed. It's energy of Zerampin, energy of given, even energy of Bina, if I'm not mistaken. Would not have been revealed. When does Chesed reveal itself? In the morning, as it is written, morning was light. Thus, as soon as the day breaks, Chesed is present in the world and judgment are removed. Right now there's judgment, right? That's why we're studying the Zohar, to connect to mercy proactively, right? We're converting judgment into mercy proactively, are removed. But when the light of the morning does not enter, judgments are not removed. As it is written, when the morning stars sang together, and all the sons of Elohim shouted for joy. That's from Yoav. When the morning stars sang together, and sons of Elohim shouted for joy. So basically, when we see the morning, and usually that's why, you know, sometimes it's good to wake up at like 6 a.m. or at sunrise. There's a practice that some people do that they look at the sunrise, right? And they say, if you look at sunrise for like 20 minutes, you're going to be so satisfied for the whole day ahead, you're not even going to need to eat or drink or anything. You're just going to be so much light, because actually that moment of sunbreak, of the sun breaking darkness and bringing in light, is a very strong force. Even 72 minutes before sunrise is the moment of breaking of the dawn. And that's actually the highest point of revelation. That's actually, it's very interesting that actually scientists say there's a lot of, I forget the name of the rays, but whatever our remote controls, TV remote controls, the wavelengths that they work on, those rays are being revealed from the sun, and they're to the highest point when they're being revealed. So it's kind of like information, a lot of information being sent. And Kabbalists have a special morning meditation for memory that we do every morning, and especially it's done ideally at the time of dawn. As soon as the stars fade away and the sun shines at the time, as it is written, a morning without clouds, and Chesed is awakened in lower worlds at that time. It is written, when morning came, since the stars disappeared and morning appeared. So basically the appreciation for morning. Morning is, you know, we can take everything for granted, but really morning is a blessing. The fact that the sun rises, it's blessing every time. 289, and we'll probably stop here this time. Amar Rabbi Yossi, Bihyot Boker Shari Kadosh Baruch Hu Leit Galia Betura De Sinai Dana Bihyot HaBoker Kad Itar Zekute De Avraham Ziketiv Beit Vayashkem Avraham BaBoker. Rabbi Yossi said that when the morning came, the whole Yom Bezdi, he started to reveal himself on Mount Sinai. We learned that when morning came means when the merit of Avram is awakened, of whom it is written, and Avram went early in the morning. We'll do one more. So let's close it on a higher note. 290. By the way, the Israelites, one of the things, what's happening the Shabbat, this portion, is what also, if you know, what happens on the holiday called Shavuot, which is 50 days after the holiday of Passover. And Shavuot is the day of immortality, the actual day when the revelation of 10 utterances occurred, and immortality was fully revealed. And what we do Kabbalistically is we don't sleep all night, we study, and it's called Tikkun Laila Shavuot. The reason is because actually Israelites were sleeping. The Creator is like, guys, I'm coming tomorrow, I'm going to reveal you immortality. End of pain, chaos, and suffering in the world. What are Israelites doing? Sleeping. The Creator had to wake them up. So the reason why we stay up is because we want to be proactive and we want to earn it. And also right now, what we're doing is we're earning and we're revealing light and immortality, right? 290. Ve'ehi kolot uvarkim amar Rabbi Abba. Kolot ketziv cheser teran kalim de'ad deru lechad da nafka min da ruha mimiya umaya meruha teren di nun chad vechad dehu teren. 290 in the English. There were thunders, kolod, and lightning. So when the actual revelation started to happen, it says that there was thunder and there was lightning. It was like, there was such a show, a spectacle of lightning and thunder. Israelites were like, okay, this is big. This is something huge is about to happen. Rabbi Abba said that kolod is spelled without, the kolod actually means voices also. It also means thunders. Spelled without vav. So now this is what happens a lot in Zohar. The Kabbalists very deciphering why certain words are written a certain way. In Hebrew, you can write the word, for example, kolot, which means thunders, with or without a certain letter, and you would still have the same meaning. So now Rabbi Abba is asking, why is it written without a vowel, which would indicate that it's plural, thunders, signifying that there were two thunders, voices that became one emanating from the other. Wind from water and water from wind. Two from that one, and that one is two. Therefore, the word kolot is written without a vav. Okay, one more. We're pushing extra mile, immortality, complete revelation, asking the light to help us in ways that we don't even know we need help, right? This is what Rav personally told me once. Ask on powerful occasions, on powerful moments. Yes, pray for things, but ask the Creator to help you change things that you don't even know you need change. That's the biggest humbling, really true, pure heart request that you can ever ask. Help me change things I don't even know I need changing. 291. Amar Rabbi Yossi, kolot chad v'ichu kala revivaka takifa delo paskat lealmin chachudi ketiv beit kol gadol velo yasaf decha shear kalin itfaskan letanya bearbaa tikufin beshata kala itfaskat ukeden dinin mitarim bealman vechai kala דקליל שאר קלין בית לא יתפסק להלמין ולא יתעבר מכיומה שלים ותוקפה דילי תנה בחי קלה קלה דקלין קלה דקליל כל שאר קלין. רבי יוסי said קולות means one. This voice is a great and strong one which never ceases, as it is written, and a great voice which was not heard again. This is from Dormatory, from Dvarim. This is because all the other voices do cease. As we learn, four times a year, the voice ceases, and then judgments are awakened in the world. But this voice, which includes the other voices, never ceases, and never abates of its full existence and force. We have learned that this voice is a voice of voices, the voice which contains all other voices. One more. 292. Amar Rabbi Yudaleit kala ela misitra delucha umaye vesa vekola evet kala vidkalil da beda vain dalit ketiv kolot uverakim amar Rabbi Yosi vechayinu diketiv berakim lematar asa Shelochova, Beture, Takira, Berachame, Bihibeta, Delo, Ishkehu. Rabbi Yehuda said, there is no voice but the one which comes from wind, water, and fire, which actually voice comes from heat, vapor, and air, which is the three columns. And all this is voice, and all this the voice performs, which is central column, and by it the columns are included in each other and become one. Therefore, the word kolod is spelled without vav, the indication of plural form. And lightning, Rabbi Yossi cites a verse and explained, and he makes lightning for the rain. And this is from King David, the Psalms, meaning that lightning is a combination of fire and water, a lightning in the rain, for the flame of the lightning in the rain indicates that it is a union of mercy with infrequent love. 22-23. Rabbi Yehuda said, we have learned the Torah was given from the side of Gura. Rabbi Yossi said, in the case of the Torah must be of the left side. He said, it returned to the right, as it is written, from his right hand went the fiery law for them. This is from Dvarim. In the right hand, Hashem is glorious in power. This is from Shemot. So we see that the left is included within the right, for it is written, for his right hand had a fiery law for them. In the right is included within the left, for it is written, your right hand, Hashem, is glorious in power. Thus, Gura, which is left, is included within the right. Okay, guys, two more. I think it's a sign we can do it. Two more paragraphs. The Anan Kavad al Hadar Veko Anana Tika Takif Dishkiya Verba Velo Natil Vekol Shofar Hazak Neod Umigu Anina Takif Hava Nafik Behukala Kavdaletale Vehi Beshamehem Ed Hakol Mitoch. And the heavy cloud upon Mount Sinai, meaning a very mighty cloud stuck in one place because of its heavens that does not move from place to place as do other clouds. And the sound of shofar exceeded loud. That sound was very strong, for it issued from the midst of a heavy cloud in order to break it, as it is written, when you heard the voice out of the midst of the darkness. So just describing what happened in Mount Sinai. So it's very hard to fathom. The moment we also connect to this is the moment when, if you watch the streaming of Shabbat, the moment we open the ark, this is what you should be experiencing. You should, for a few minutes, close your eyes, envision yourself standing on Mount Sinai and seeing this thunder, this lightning, these sounds, these farts. Really, like, a little bit confusing, you know. It's like puts you in a frenzy a little bit. 295. Amar Rabbi Yehuda, Talad Hashoke Chavod Yiketif Shochech Anan VeRafel VeChachu Kala Chavu Nafik Ben Yehat Mikulchu Amar Rabbi Yossi Ben Yehat. Rabbi Yehuda said, there are three kinds of darkness, for it is written, darkness, clouds, and thick darkness. This is from Dvarim. And that voice, namely the voice of Shofar, came forth as the innermost depth. For Rabbi Yossi said that the innermost of all of them was the voice of which it is written, a great voice which was not heard again. Okay, everyone, thank you for joining. I feel like going again, but it's already an hour. So thank you, everyone, for joining. I think we should, you know, a way to really review and soak up all the light is just to appreciate this opportunity that we had. You know, I personally understand the Zohar and connect to the light of the Zohar and the wisdom so much more, that the fact that all of you are here and the fact that we have this opportunity. So really to appreciate this moment, this special, amazing opportunity we have, where we can like lift ourselves and connect to truth. You know, this is real. Imagine, why are we here? Because we feel energy, right? And is it based on something? Did we eat something? Did we drink something? No, we're just connecting to wisdom. We're just connecting to light. So this amazing opportunity that we have to connect to this incredible light of the Zohar, the light of the creator, the light of immortality, and also to connect to the appreciation and responsibility we have to connect to more and more people. Because eventually, if enough people connect to this, to just do a study also, let your friends know that study Kabbalah and tell them about this. It's open for all, not closed for anyone. So the more people will connect to wisdom of Kabbalah, we're just going to experience what we're experiencing right now forever. It's only going to increase. So God willing, as it says about the shofar, that the shofar is going to break over darkness. This light of the study is going to be like our shofar. It's going to break all darkness, klipot, confusion, uncertainty, fears, anxiety in our life, and have a light of immortality be the beacon of our existence. So thank you everyone for joining. Really appreciate it. Have an amazing Shabbat. Have an amazing day. Share light. Share. Give energy. Be in the mode of giving. Be in the mode of how can I contribute more? How can I give more? Even to the people that you don't like, that you don't feel deserve it. Like the Israelites. They didn't deserve the immortality and Torah, and the Creator still gave it to them. So be even giving to people that you feel like, oh, they don't even deserve it. Extend your mercy to as much as possible.